So we're going to start with a blank piece of paper and a pen. Old technology, yeah? I said on the channel, on the intro, if you watch the intro, I want to teach electronic repair from the beginning, really. And to understand electronic repair, okay, I'm showing you practical videos of everyday repair jobs. But to really understand it, you need to understand about electricity, about voltage and current and resistance. These are really like the founding rules, the laws of electricity. And you need to understand about electronic components and what they do. I was going to say how they work. You don't need to know how they work. You just need to know what they do. Because you're interested in finding something that's working or isn't working. And all you want to know is it working or is it not? You don't want to know how does this do what it does and why doesn't it do what it does. You know, it's just either good or bad, and that's what we need to know. But we still need to understand what components do. And we need to understand some circuits, which we come across commonly. But let's start from the very, very beginning. What's electricity? Well, it was discovered in 1752 by Benjamin Franklin, who had a bright idea of flying kites in thunderstorms, and having received something of an electrical shock, and managed to work out that lightning is electricity. Before that, scientists had some inkling. They knew about static electricity and such like, but he's the one really that formulated the proof effectively, and he's considered widely to be the guy who discovered electricity. So that was 1752 discovered. Now, I was taught in the early 80s, yes, I've been playing with electronics since the mid 70s or earlier 70s, but I was really taught in the early 1980s. And I'm going to teach you now, or show you now, the way that I was explained on the very first lesson I went, what's electricity? And the guy who taught me used an analogy, which I think everybody can understand. So this is what he did, and this is what he drew on the board. He said, this is a water tank, yeah? Full of water. And this is a pipe. And the pipe comes down here. And this is a bucket, yeah? And we can put a tap here, but we won't bother with a tap. But he basically says, when the tap's turned on, what happens? Well, water comes out the pipe, yeah, and starts to fill the bucket. It does. He says, how much water comes out of that pipe? Well, I'd say, how long is a piece of string? He says, yeah, it's right, Dickie, but there's some rules here. Let's have a think about what affects the amount of water that comes out of this pipe. He says, the first thing that is going to affect it is the width of the pipe, yeah? The wider the pipe, yeah, the more water comes out. That's quite obvious, yeah? The other thing that's going to affect it is the pressure of the water. The higher the water pressure, so if you go put this on top of a mountain and have a very long pipe, or if you can't be bothered to do that, so you put a plunger in here, yeah, and you press down the plunger. The more pressure you put on here for a given width of pipe, the more pressure on here, the more water will come out. That's obvious. That's electricity, basically. Scientists, Franklin in particular, thought that electricity was a kind of like an invisible fluid, yeah, and they determined that electricity flows in the circuit, and it flows from positive, where there is the invisible fluid, to negative, where there isn't. And that's basically what electricity is. So that was 1750. Then around about 1800, a guy named Volta invented the battery, the modern battery, which basically uses a chemical reaction to produce electricity. Very clever guy. So we now have batteries. And they started putting together circuits, and they started to experiment. So they said, okay, well, here's a battery, plus, minus, yeah, and we'll stick between here and here, yeah, across these are wires, and we'll stick various materials across here, and we'll see what they do. Does everything conduct electricity? Does the flow through everything? And they obviously very quickly discovered that some materials pass electricity very well, and some don't, and some none at all, or not any that's even measurable, and some kind of pass electricity but not very well. So the ones that were passing electricity well, they called them conductors. Yeah. And conductors, for the main part, really, they're metals. So copper, iron, zinc, various different gold, silver, you know, they probably tried everything, you know, and they found that metals are conductors. Yeah, the ones that don't conduct electricity are called insulators, and for the main part these are non-metals, so wood, stone, they didn't have plastic in them days, so I can't say plastic, hair, you know, things like that, dead rat, whatever, they found doesn't conduct electricity, that's an insulator. And then they found some things which are in between these, which they are conductors, but they're just not very good conductors. So a good example of this is carbon, yeah? And they effectively called this property of some things conduct, some things conduct to an extent and some things don't, they called it resistance. Okay, so the better the conductor, the less resistance the flow, that makes sense. Yeah, the better the insulator, the more resistance. So we now have a few factors coming here. We have volts. Volta invented the battery, and using different chemicals he found some batteries produce more electricity than others. Yeah, and they called that, the amount of electricity, they called it volts after Volta. Okay. This business over the width of this pipe, this is the resistance. In as much as like some things are conductors and more than others, and the amount of conductance we call the resistance, or the amount of like the resistance against the conduction is resistance, yeah? This is the same as this. So the wider the pipe, the more it conducts, the more it flows the water. So a wider pipe has less resistance than a narrower pipe, yeah? Your volts is equivalent to this plunger here. So the more pressure you put on that, that's the more volts, yeah? The width of the pipe, that is the resistance, yeah? R for resistance. And the amount of water that's coming down here, that's the current. You can remember that because you get currents and water, don't you? Yeah. So that's the current. And you'd think, wouldn't you, that current would be C. So you think you'd have V for volts, R for resistance, C for current, but you don't. Current is I. And the reason it's I, it comes from the French, which is like intensity de courant, which basically means like the intensity of flow. So even to this day, current is I. So we have three important factors, yeah? And this leads to the most important rule of electricity that describes this system very well, and it describes this system very well. And this comes from a guy named Ohm, okay? And he's a German guy, scientist. When did he do it? 1827. Although nobody took much notice, actually, for a few years after that. They weren't overly impressed. But Ohm's law, eventually, I think by the 1870s, he was considered to be a genius. He was awarded, you know, some very high awards. I'm not sure if he was still alive. But anyway, Ohm's law, yeah? And what Ohm's law says is basically this. It says, the more pressure on here, the more current will flow down the pipe for a given width of pipe, yeah? Simple as that. The wider the pipe, if the pressure stays the same, the wider the pipe, the more current flows down the pipe. He's just describing that, really. And Ohm's law, the easiest way to express it, and this is the only bit of maths I'm going to do on this channel. If I do anything else, I'll be very surprised. But this one is the one we need. Voltage. Yeah. We put this in a triangle. This is the way to do it. Look, voltage equals resistance times, you put it this way, voltage equals current times resistance. Yeah, we could say voltage equals resistance times current, but everybody does it that way, yeah? Voltage equals current times resistance. V equals IR. So V equals I times R. That's Ohm's law. From this one, we can sake, that's voltage. Sorry, if you want to know the current, yeah, current equals V over R. It's basic algebra. I'm not going to teach you maths on here, but that's true. Believe it or go and look up some algebra to understand formulas why that is true, yeah? And resistance equals V over I. So if you know the voltage, if you know any two of these, you can calculate the third one. So if you know the voltage is 10, yeah? And you know the current is 1, then the resistance is 10, because 10 equals 1 times 10. Voltage is measured in volts, yeah? Current is measured in amps, yeah? And resistance, because this guy was so clever and we need to honour him, is measured in ohms. So there we have. If we know voltage is 10 and we know the resistance is 10, the current will be 1. If we increase the voltage to 20 and this stays 10, then the only way this can be true is I times R has got to be 2 times 10. So if you increase the voltage to 20, the current's now 2 for the same resistance, yeah? If we reduce the resistance to 5, yeah? This is still 20, so 2 times 5 is 10. That can't be the case. We've reduced this to 5, so this must now be 4. 20 equals 4 times 5. And that's basically Ohm's law. You can work the other ones the same way. It's just the easiest way to see in your head, but all those are true, yeah? So we put them in a triangle like this. V, I, R. And we can look straight away at this triangle. If we want to know the voltage, it's I times R, yeah? If you want to know the resistance, it's V divided by I. If you want to know the current, it's V divided by R. That's why it's in a triangle, and that's why it's so easy to remember that one. So that's basically what electricity is, and what Ohm's law is, and why it's important. And this is the first electronic component we're going to learn about, the resistor. Okay? And we know from Ohm's law that a resistor controls the flow of current. The higher the resistance, the more resistant it is, the less current that flows. The lower the resistor, effectively the more conductive it is, the more current that flows. That's Ohm's law. The only thing, one other thing I want to mention, now keep this nice and short and simple. So back in 1750, Franklin came along and he formulated this is what electricity is. And Ohm came along and said, yeah, well, that's the laws, that's how it works. And they assumed that electricity flows from positive to negative. You know, that was quite a reasonable thing to assume. And then the batteries invented 50 years after this Franklin's discovered. And then Ohm's law comes along in 1827. After that, not long after, Faraday invents the dynamo, 1831. The motor's invented 1834, electric motor, the light bulb, which basically is just a resistor that it gets hot and glows, by the way. The light bulb, Edison, 1879, electric light bulb, and everything's honky-dory, and then some bright sparks, come along in 1897, yeah? And they discover the principle of the structure of an atom. And they say that an atom has a nucleus. In the nucleus, we have protons and we have neutrons, yeah? And the protons have a positive electrical charge and the neutrons don't have any. And around this nucleus, like an orbit of planets or moon, more like an orbit of moons, really, we have electrons. And these electrons are negative, yeah? And these electrons are what's actually moving in that conductor. So electricity, the movement, the particles are actually negative. So current doesn't flow from positive to negative, it flows from negative to positive. And they must have thought, oh my God, we were wrong, you know. It's the opposite way around. But by now, we'd had like 150 years of science, of universities and schools and engineers and scientists and people working electricity, and they'd all got used to the fact that it flows from positive to negative. So you could say, well, if we're going to change all that learning, we're going to have to like rewrite thousands, maybe tens or hundreds of thousands of scientific papers, textbooks, and you know, probably millions by the time you're doing the textbooks. And we're going to have to reverse in people's heads the fact that it goes negative to positive. And I don't think they decided not to do that. I think they're just lazy, you know. And somebody probably says, well, does it really matter? Does it really matter whether we think this is like some sort of magic fluid going from positive to negative, or whether we know it's electrons going from negative to positive? Because the net result's the same. It still flows through the circuit, and the conductors conduct, and the resistors resist, and the light bulb gets hot. And we don't really care which way the things are moving, whether they're going that way or that way. It still works. So basically, they never changed it. It was never, ever changed. Even though for the last 120 years we know this is wrong, we still do this today. And this, the current flow, from plus to minus, yeah? Yeah, this current flow, plus to minus, is called conventional current, yeah? That's the imagined version of what's happened. The truth, minus to plus, is called electron current. And really, it doesn't matter which you use. I'm quite a conventional guy in some respects, maybe not in others. And I'm going to stick with conventional current like everybody else does. So when we look at circuits from the point of view repair, we're going to consider that the current's flowing from positive to negative. The only time that might look a bit strange is when we talk about certain components and the symbols of the component, which have arrows in the symbol. You think, why is that arrow pointing the wrong way? You know, if it's going from like, you know, the direction of conventional current, the arrow should be pointing the other way, and it should do. But the symbol that's used for these components is showing the electron flow, electron current. So that's probably the only time you ever really need to, you know, it's like strikes you. Conventional current's wrong, you know. Okay, so I hope the guy who taught me in the 80s taught me in a way that I can explain this to you. And I hope that was clearer than mud. Any comments, any questions, please post on the channel. I'm going to divide this channel into playlists. So we'll have a playlist for circuits and components, electricity, and we'll have a playlist for the practical repairs as we go along. Okay, so see you on the channel. Next one of these type of tutorials is going to be on resistors, and we're going to look at resistors, what they look like. We can examine them in circuits a little bit. What properties, we can look at Ohm's law a little bit. We can blow a few things up, you know. We can burn a few things, why not? Because that there's nothing better than that will actually prove that this is right, yeah. Okay, so let's have some more fun soon, and I'll see you back on the channel.